Good day, everybody. Welcome to a dissection of the popliteal fossa. I'm Dr. Sanjay Sanyal, Professor and Department Chair. So let's take a look at the boundaries of the popliteal fossa. We can see a diamond-shaped space here on the back of the knee. The cadaver is prone, this is the left leg. That's superior, this is inferior, this is medial, this is lateral. Let's take the boundaries. This is the supramedial boundary, the supralateral boundary. The supramedial boundary is composed of these two muscles here. This is the semitendinosus, and under that, this is the semimembranosus. Both are the hamstring muscles, and they are both supplied by tibial division of the sciatic nerve. The supralateral boundary is formed by the biceps femoris, composed of a long head of biceps and a short head of biceps, and they are the ones which form the supralateral boundary, and the short head is supplied by the common fibular division, and the long head is supplied by the tibial division. Coming to the inframedial and the infralateral boundaries. The inframedial boundary is the medial head of the gastrocnemius. And the infralateral boundary is composed of the lateral head of the gastrocnemius. And under that, we have this muscle here, which is called the plantaris muscle. So these two constitute the infralateral boundary. So this is the diamond-shaped structure. So therefore, the popliteal fossa, which is at the back of the knee, has got an apex above, an apex below, and two angles on the sides. The roof of the popliteal fossa is composed of a superficial fascia which contains the posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, which has been removed, and it also contains under that a deep fascia, which is the popliteal fascia. The cut margin of the popliteal fascia is visible here. The rest has been removed. This is part of the popliteal fascia. Similarly, on this side also, most of the popliteal fascia has been removed. This popliteal fascia is actually a deep fascia which is continuous with the fascia latae above and with the crural fascia below. Let's come now to the floor of the popliteal fossa. This is the floor of the popliteal fossa, and you can see very clearly how deep it is. The floor of the popliteal fossa is composed of three structures. Going from above below, we have this portion here. This is the popliteal surface of the femur. Below that, this portion here is the posterior capsule of the knee joint. And further below, we have this muscle here. A little bit of that is visible here. This is the popliteus muscle. This forms the lower part of the floor. And incidentally, we can see some of the expansions of the semimembranosus muscle, which forms the oblique popliteal ligament and also contributes to the popliteus fascia, and we can see that here. So they all constitute the floor of the popliteal fossa. Now let's come to the contents of the popliteal fossa. Let me show you the orientation. Right on top, superficially, we see the structure here. This is the tibial nerve. Nerve, just under that we have the vein and we have the artery. So a simple mnemonic is from superficial to deep and from lateral to medial, we have the nerve, vein, artery. From lateral to medial, nerve, vein, artery, and from superficial to deep or from posterior to anterior, we have the nerve, vein, artery. Let's take them one by one. This was the sciatic nerve, which came from the back of the thigh, and it divided at the junction of the upper two-thirds and the lower one-third. Sometimes it divides a little lower down into the larger division, the tibial component, the preaxial component, which is L5, S1, 2, 3, and the postaxial component or the common fibular component, which is L4, 5, S1, 2. The tibial component runs vertically down from one apex of the popliteal fossa to the lower apex too. And this tibial nerve supplies all the muscles in the back of the thigh and the back of the knee, back of the leg, and goes right up to the sole of the foot. The common fibula runs obliquely, laterally, and it is under cover of the biceps. And as it comes laterally, we can see it winds around the neck of the fibula. This is a very important place, and this is the place where if there's a fibular fracture, the common fibular nerve can be injured and the patient will have foot drop. And after that, it goes under the fibularis longus muscle. There, it divides into a superficial fibular nerve and a deep fibular nerve. So this is the common fibular division. Okay. The common fibular supplies the muscles of the anterior and lateral compartment, and it further goes down to the foot. But in the popliteal fossa, it gives a branch to the short head of the biceps. So this is an exception. All the other muscles are supplied by the tibial division. The common fibular supplies the short head of the biceps. One more branch that we can see here. This is this branch of the common fibular, the lateral sural cutaneous nerve, which is a cutaneous nerve which supplies the back of the legs. So that's one content. Now let's take a look at the next content. So let's start from the top. We can see an oval-shaped opening here. This oval-shaped opening is the adductor hiatus, where my instrument has gone in. This adductor hiatus is the opening between the two insertions of the adductor magnus, between the adductor component and the hamstring component of the adductor magnus. And it is from here that the femoral artery and the femoral vein, they pass through and they enter the popliteal fossa. And here they change their name from femoral vessels to popliteal vessels. So now what we are seeing here is the popliteal vein and the popliteal artery. Popliteal artery gives rise to five branches in the popliteal fossa: superior, inferior, medial, lateral, genicular branches. Some of those branches are visible here, I have written, but many of those branches had to be sacrificed. Additionally, it gives numerous branches to the muscles and articular branches. As we trace the popliteal artery further down, we find that the popliteal artery, it disappears from the popliteal fossa by passing under this muscle. This is the soleus muscle. And this portion of the soleus muscle that you see here, this is known as the tendinous arch of soleus. It disappears under the tendinous arch of soleus, and this is where it divides into a posterior tibial, a larger division, and an anterior tibial. So this is the course of the popliteal artery. The popliteal vein also follows a similar course, and the tributaries of the popliteal vein match branches of the popliteal artery. Now let me tell you something very important, and that is a clinical correlation. The popliteal vessels, especially the popliteal artery, can get entrapped in three locations. The first location that it can get entrapped is at the adductor hiatus. The second site of entrapment is, if you note, the popliteal artery is running very close to the origin of the medial head of the gastrocnemius. And this is where it can get entrapped. In fact, there's a very complex classification called the Love and Whelan classification, which mentions six different types of popliteal artery entrapment by the medial head of the gastrocnemius. And collectively, they are referred to as PAES, popliteal artery entrapment syndrome. So this is the second place where the popliteal artery and sometimes the popliteal vein can get entrapped. And the third place where the popliteal artery can get entrapped is when it is passing under the tendinous arch of soleus. I want to show you a few other structures. Take a look at this structure. This is the short saphenous vein. We started from the lateral side of the foot and it traveled on the back of the leg and it pierced through the popliteus fascia and it opens into the popliteal vein, and we can see. The clinical significance of the short saphenous vein is that the short saphenous vein is accompanied by a nerve here, and that is called the sural nerve. We use this vein as a landmark to identify the sural nerve for nerve grafting, like for example, injury of the facial nerve. And of course, during clearance of the popliteal fossa, we had to remove the fat, and you can see the depth of the popliteal fossa is almost as deep as the length of a finger. So all this was filled with fat, and it also contained a group of lymph nodes which are collectively referred to as the popliteal lymph nodes. So these are the important salient points about the popliteal fossa and its contents. Thank you very much for watching, ladies and gentlemen. If you have any questions or comments, put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Have a nice day.
Hey guys, don't forget to like and subscribe.